Imagine that you could take your ordinary street car, take it to a track, and have a pro and a coach show you how to get through all the turns and really drive it. Automotive journalist Del Coates is going to do just that. Del, welcome to Road Trip.
Hi, Mark.
What car are we going to take out on the track?
How about the BMW 335i hardtop convertible?
Excellent. Let's do it.
Okay. This is Thunderhill Raceway, and we're at an event sponsored by Hooked on Driving. That's an organization that appeals to driving enthusiasts, many of whom want to become performance or race car drivers. Okay, they want to go out and win the 24 hours of Le Mans or whatever. I'm not one of those people. I enjoy driving, especially this thing, but we were at the annual watch meeting, and I won the grand prize, which was a day of driving at Hooked on Driving. So I get to go around this marvelous race course with coaches sitting beside me, and they are teaching me how to drive. And I must say that I have gotten a bit better today.
Tell me about this wonderful car. How did it come into your life?
Well, I have never really had a convertible. And I should, by the time you get to be this old, you should have a convertible in your life. Now, with the exception of a 55 Sunbeam Alpine I restored, that was the only convertible. But it wasn't a daily driver. So I've been fascinated by these retractable hardtops. I'm just fascinated by the mechanism.
It is.
And so when they started showing up here, like the EOS and then the Volvo, and I definitely decided I wanted to get one. Okay, but then my wife put another factor into the equation. She wanted to see if I could find something I could pick up in Europe, because she likes to travel to Europe. So we try to do these combinations. So the BMW was, we knew it was coming out, and on the faith of some things I'd read and on driving the 3 Series coupes, I said, I'm going to buy one. So I ordered it without even knowing what it was going to cost. And as the time got closer and closer, I still didn't know. And literally within days of leaving for Europe, I found out what it was going to cost. I choked. But my wonderful wife said, go ahead and do it.
Whoa. Yeah. Where did you find her?
That's another story.
That's right. That is another story. But it was love at first sight.
All right.
Okay, so I ordered it for pickup in Munich.
Yeah.
And which is a good deal. You can realize a savings of about 7%, and they pick up some of the airfare. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was worthwhile, except for the 2-month wait, for it to get back. But the cost includes all the shipping and all that. And in fact, it included insurance. While we were drove
it for about a month in Europe.
Germany, Switzerland, Italy, Spain, France a little bit.
So anyway, it's a wonderful car.
I knew it would be. I knew it would be a wonderful car to drive.
What did you find out about it on the track that you didn't know on the street?
Well, I knew it would handle the course well. There's no question about that. The only question was my ability to extract what it had to offer. Because I've never aspired to be a race car driver, and I've always wished I could drive better, and so I took full advantage of, I had an instructor with me the whole time as I go around the course. And
So what kind of a grade did he give you, Del?
I don't remember any mention of grades. They all said I did well.
You so, did. Great. And as a matter of fact, I think I did, especially towards the end. And I guess the thing I learned was that a good car can make a good driver out of you. I mean, I felt good about the way I pushed this thing around the course.
There's a sequence to the entry of a turn, and we put them in real simple terms. Brake, shift, turn, gas. Okay? Does that make sense? Does that, you can visually, mentally think that through, and you realize, oh, you know, if I'm driving on the freeway and I'm going 70 miles an hour and I pull my Corvette off on the exit ramp, I can slap it up from, you know, I can just drop her in fourth, drop it in third, not even touch the brake, you know, because I'm not really stressing the car. I'm just kind of trying to slow down a little bit. Well, in this environment, when you need to slow down, you want to slow down quickly and quite a bit, right? So you can't, if you do the gear shift first, guess what's going to happen? Bang, the motor's going to go, wah! Okay, now that might sound like really cool performance driving. It's not. And there is a saying in performance driving, brakes are way cheaper than engines. Okay, so that's why we say brake first. And that's why the coaches in your earpiece are going, brake, 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 if you're not. Okay, so the brake first. Get the car settled in a straight line. Get your shift done. Get the car down to the speed you need it to be in for the next gear. Well, you know, the beginners, we don't generally talk about heel and toe. If you know how to heel and toe, that's great. But blipping that throttle is good. But dropping the RPMs on the engine so that you, when you release the clutch into the new gear, you haven't over-revved the engine. You've got everything under control. Then you turn the car. Okay? That the front end of the car is settled. It's, you don't have any wig-wag going. And it also defeats this thing called understeer. If you go in hot, anybody want to guess on what understeer or push is? You ever heard the term?
Understeer is when your car doesn't want to turn, it goes through the turn?
That's correct. In fact, I'm going to quote a friend of mine, Randy Popst. Understeer is when you turn and you hit the wall in the front. Okay? All right, so you turn and you're going too fast, the car doesn't want to turn. So most street cars are actually tuned with an alignment that will make them plow, because actually that's the safest way to crash if you're going to be a stupid person out on the streets. So you got to take the understeer out of the car by slowing down and letting that front end bite and get turned. Okay, so you surrender up a little speed on the entry, turn in, and then immediately with the eyes up, you're seeing as you're driving through the apex. The minute you've got the apex, then look at the track out point next, and you're feeding throttle and on out to the exit. Oversteer is the opposite, where if you, for instance, get the car on gas and you're in a turn and the rear end wants to break loose and you have to steer with the rear end to prevent it from coming around. So if cars were tuned from the factory to oversteer, you'd have people doing snap spins all the time because they'd be catching the wheel and everything. I was in a race car. I was teaching a new owner of a race car at turn one 2 weeks ago, and he was doing very well. Well, we go through one, and he wasn't quite getting all the way out to the track out, and he wasn't trusting that there was room out there. He was leaving 6 or 8 feet, okay? So I was saying, track out, track out, track out. Well, we got it really good. He came out, and he was going to make it to the edge, but at the last minute, he just wasn't sure, so he went, ah. and we did this big, hairy, nasty spin and ended up in some of the Thunderhill dirt.
Okay, as we go out now, stay to the right-hand side of the course through turn one. Do not cross over onto the apex.
All the way to the outside. Get on the outside. No brakes.
No brakes.
Turn now. Accelerate. Use all the cores, all the way to the outside. You keep over the right, brake now, brake, turn, accelerate. Well, you do that nice.
I hope you got that on the tape.
What, do you do it nice?
When you are, Steve.
Okay. Here we go. There, this turn eight coming up, no brakes. Takes a man to do it without brakes, okay. Turn now, accelerate. Use all the road. Come on. There you go.
You know, BMWs have always had this, it's almost like an intuition. They seem to know what you want to do. You just sort of have to think about it, and you make those inputs, and it's compatible. It really is a back and forth, that, and you just, it sounds like a cliche.
No,
but
no,
you,
it doesn't.
But
no,
it
no.
really does feel like an extension of you.
Yeah, or a participation. You know, well, when I've driven them too. I mean, it just feels like it's enjoying the ride too.
I
remember on one of our track days, I drove a Porsche and then I drove a BMW. And the Porsche was very much like a samurai, very precise, very clean. And the BMW felt eager. Do you ever get that kind of an eager feeling from these guys?
They're you know, BMWs really are a phenomenon. I mean, I love Porsches. And as a matter of fact, I even seriously considered getting a Boxster instead, even though it was a ragtop. But I'm just glad I got this finally.
Yeah.
I mean, it cost more than my first two houses put together. but it's just a wonderful car. I fall in love with it every time I back it out of the garage.
Yeah.
And. You know, I don't think it's the greatest looking car. I mean, this, I think, happens to be one of the better looking BMWs.
Absolutely.
I happen to be an Audi kind of a guy. I mean, that's the kind of design I really like. But, you know, I think Bangle and his boys are justly proud of what they've been able to achieve here. I mean, when you think about it, you know, most of these hardtop convertibles end up with a real high bustle back.
Oh, they do, don't they?
Yeah.
They really angle up so they look real wedgy.
And this really has a very normal line.
Yeah.
And yet, they managed to win an award for ending up with enough trunk volume, to be useful. I mean, that's a matter of interpretation.
Yeah.
But they did a very clever job. And one reason why you see this unusual, you know, external mechanism here was in order to get this thing to really close up in a very compact fashion. And this, you know, these two panels, when they come up, they just nest very closely.
Okay.
And then the whole thing fits into that trunk, and it's a masterful job. And to boot, unlike normal convertibles, this thing is a rock-solid, quiet coupe. I've seldom driven a coupe that's as quiet as this.
Yeah.
I mean, it's as quiet as any coupe I've ever driven. I mean, the wind noise is nil.
Wow.
And furthermore, with the top down, even with the windows down at freeway speeds, I can comfortably listen to the radio. And I think that's a marvelous thing.
Does it have one of those little walls that goes behind?
But frankly, I didn't feel like spending the $500 for it. I think they come standard on the Volvo and the Volkswagen. I'm not certain of that, but I think so.
Have to have a kind of a large credit card too.
That's right, and that was kind of the line. That's where I drew the line.
Yeah.
I said no.
Yeah. And the $400 iPod connection.
Oh yeah, right. And I don't want to really go into the details of that, but it's spooky.
Yes.
And it's not what you expect when you buy something called an iPod interface.
Yeah. Well, so. my final question to you, Dell, is that are automotive journalists really smart enough to get in out of the rain?
I'm getting there.
Yeah.
I think it depends on how heavy the rain is.
Yeah, that's true.
And,
well, I'm
getting hard for me to see you actually with all this water on my.
Well, congratulations on on your track day.
Thank you.
And,
I enjoyed it. I really did.
Road Trip is a production of the Auto Channel.